Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. First one is this: rejoice. That's the first thing he says to do. And he says it twice, which means it's extra important. He's like saying, hello, 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 attention please, because he had to say it twice, because he thought it was that important. Rejoice. It says it in verse 4, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Now, this is fascinating because I just think, okay, what does this have to do with anything? I'm anxious, I'm fear-based, and he's saying rejoice. Like, what is, what? So I thought, you know, I'm going to look up this word in the original Greek language. And this shed a whole new light on it. This particular word used in this particular sentence means cheerful or calmly happy. You might want to write that in the margin of your Bible next to verse 4, that this word rejoice translated in the original Greek means cheerful or calmly happy. That brings a whole different connotation to my mind. Doesn't it kind of bring a different flavor to this word? What comes to mind when you think of someone who is cheerful? When I think of someone being cheerful, I think of someone believing that God has something good in store. No matter what the circumstances are right now, that cheerful person always is like, I just expect the best. I just expect that God has something good in store. They have that kind of thought process that I always think something good is coming up. God has something good in store. So that's a little clue for us. What comes to mind when you think of someone who is calmly happy? Calmly happy. I think of having that steady certainty that no matter what the circumstances look like right now, I know that God is in control and he's a good father. Because then I'm just calmly happy. No matter what's swirling around in my world or what I think could be happening, it's like I just have this steady trust that God is in control and he's a good God. And so I'm just kind of like calmly happy. And this describes a person who believes God's promises, especially the one in Romans 8:28. This promise, I seem to revisit this like daily because I need to hold on to this one. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. That calmly happy person, that cheerful person, believes Romans 8:28, right? Because no matter what's swirling around you, no matter what you're fearing could happen, you're like, calmly happy, cheerful, because you know God's in control. And even if your worst fear comes to pass, God can bring something good out of it. So you're like calmly happy. Okay, the number 3 ingredient here in overcoming anxiety: discipline your mind not to be worried or fearful about anything. Discipline your mind not to be worried or fearful about anything. Verse 6 says, do not be anxious about anything. Pretty clear, right? And Paul writes this as a command, not a suggestion or based on how you feel. Don't we? I think human beings tend to wait for our feelings to guide us. And so we're always just like waiting to not be anxious, waiting to not feel anxiety anymore. We could probably wait a long time for that, right? But I don't see Paul saying, wait for the feeling to come. He just says, don't be anxious. Like we're actually going to choose, and we're going to discipline our mind not to be anxious. So this must mean that we have a choice when it comes to worrying. So how do we choose not to worry? Well, we find the answer in 2 Corinthians 10:5. We destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God and take every thought captive to obey Christ. So I don't know about you, but sometimes on an hourly basis or maybe even a minute-by-minute basis, I sometimes have to just like take those thoughts captive acknowledge, like, wait a minute, like on my walk today, like all of a sudden, what if my husband dies today of a heart attack and I can't pay the mortgage? And then going down this rabbit trail, like, well, how would I scrape together the money? And you know, you're starting to feel your heart go faster, not just from the walking, but from the stress. And I have to like take that thought captive and say, wait a minute, I'm not going down this path. I'm gonna discipline my mind to think about something else. So don't welcome in that thought and let it tie you up in knots. Instead, take all those what if thoughts, and here's a great question to ask. You might want to even write this down. Ask the Lord, even if this fear becomes reality, what does your word say to me? Even if this fear does become reality, what does your word say to me? This takes all the wind out of the sails of that anxious thought and that fearful thought, because it acknowledges, like, okay, that could happen, but what does your word promise me? What does your word say to me? Some truths from God's word that we can train our minds to obey when we start to get anxious. I want to just give you some suggestions. How about Hebrews 13:5, I will never leave you nor forsake you. That's a great thing to just train your mind to go to instead of going down this rabbit trail where you're like starting to worry about, you know, people dying, or, you know, oh, I've got a headache, I probably have a brain tumor, or, you know, whatever we start to get anxious about, right? And instead, you train your mind, you redirect your thoughts, you discipline your mind to go to God's truth. Even if this happened, what does God's word say to me? How about this one from Isaiah 49? Shout for joy, you heavens, rejoice, you earth, burst into song, you mountains, for the Lord comforts his people and will have compassion on his afflicted ones. So when that fearful thought comes in, that anxious thought, what if this happens? What if that happens? What if this happens? You say, even if that happens, God said he's going to comfort me and he has compassion on me and he also will never leave me nor forsake me. It's like,